Good morning and welcome to worship with Stapleford Salvation Army. Usually at the start of our meetings we have the notices read out telling us what has happened in the last week and what is going to happen in the week ahead. Well, this morning we have two notices to be read out and these are from our young people. Alfie would like to tell you what he's been up to this past week, and then we have a message from H who wants to send a message to each of you.
Hello to all my friends at the Army. I thought I would tell you what I've been up to this week. I've been in the paddling pool, hopefully we get back in there again, and I've been on walks with my mummy, and I've also been doing schoolwork. Me and Dad have been playing in the garden nearly 7 days a week, and we all miss you and hope you're all well and safe. Love, Alfie.
Hi, it is H. Here, miss you all lots. Love you all. Can you wait to see you soon? Stay safe from the coronavirus.
Thank you, young people. I think we should have notices like those every week. But let us now put aside all those things that have been cluttering our minds, perhaps causing us anxiety or fear. And together, let us choose now to worship our King, our Saviour, the Lord of Lords.
Sing with me, how great is our God.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come this morning with hearts full of praise and worship to you. Father God, indeed, we say how great thou art. Father God, we welcome you to our meeting this morning. I pray that for every person that is listening, that Father God, you give us receptive hearts and minds ready to listen and to receive from you. Father God, you are welcome here. So, Father God, we commit this meeting to you. Amen. Well, I'm sure we all have verses of scripture that we go to, perhaps when we're feeling anxious or afraid. And this morning, another of our young people, Charlie, would like to share with you the verse that is special to him. And it comes from Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 to 7.
Philippians 4, 6 and 7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, thanksgiving present to you God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus.
Let us pray. Lord, at this unsettling time, we pray for your mercy across our nation and the world. Continue to give wisdom to government and health experts so that they can advise us about the best action that we can take. Please give the NHS and other health and care sector staff the daily strength they need to endure through this difficult time. Help each one of us to act responsibly, to help others, and to keep our eyes fixed on you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. My morning meeting is based around the theme, Forgiven, Restored and Released. And two of our young people have chosen scripture based around this theme. We also have Ella has also chosen a poem to read This is also very relevant to this week's message. The scripture readings come from Matthew 6, verses 14 and 15, and Colossians 3, verses 12 and 14. So, let us listen to Ruby, Alfie, and Ella.
Matthew 6, verse 14 to 15. If you forgive others the wrong they have done to you, your Father in heaven will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, then your Father will not forgive the wrongs you have done.
This is from Colossians 3, verses 12 to 14. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity.
Sometimes when we live with other people, it's hard to forgive them. I thought this poem was very relevant. When the cloud of past sin darkens up your way, remember God wiped out misdeeds and of yesterday. He remembers nevermore the wicked things once done. Now he only sees you through the grace of his Son. When the cloud of former sin moves across your path, remember you no longer will have to face God's wrath. He forgets all about your former wickedness, now that he only sees you through the eyes of righteousness. When the cloud of ancient sin starts to descend down upon you, remember God has blotted out your past from his eternal view.
There may be someone watching today who perhaps feels lost, lonely, overlooked, unloved. Perhaps you're feeling that with all that has happened since this virus took hold, that your dreams cannot now be fulfilled. But that is not true. And the song that we're going to now sing speaks to each one of us. God has not forgotten us. He loves and he knows us by name. So don't think that God will fail to understand. He knows and he cares. I hope you will all join in with this beautiful song written by John Gowans.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, these may be familiar words to many of us, a song that we have sung many times before. But Father God, this morning I pray that the words come alive and speak into our hearts to meet us where we are. For those of us who are perhaps feeling lonely and isolated, reassure them now that they have not been forgotten. Please come alongside them right where they are. Let them feel your arms around them, reassuring them that you are there and you understand. I ask this in your precious name. Amen. Well, this morning, Jake, a member of our youth cell, has also taken up the theme of restoration. And he is going to read a poem that again speaks to us all. So let us listen.
When Captain Vicky mentioned to me about doing something on the theme of restoration, I thought of the Morris that my dad has been restoring for many years now. And then I found this poem by Louis Ram. It's called Restoration of Faith. The restoration of faith and undying love was given to us from the Lord above. This restoration will be everlasting. Jesus then said, "The same way that God has given it to me, I will give it to thee. I will restore in you the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. This is the gift you will treasure the most. For if you are pure in mind and deed, whatever you do will succeed. Faith in me and faith in God is a restoration from start. And it begins with your heart. So open up your mind and hear what I say. He had this from the very first day, of when you were baptized with water to erase mortal sin, and over the devil you would win. This is the restoration that I give to you. Hold it dear, hold it true."
Let us now listen and be taken into the presence of God through music. Neil, our bandmaster, and Ella, his daughter, will now bring us a duet, which will give glory to God and also take us to the throne of grace.
Today's Bible reading is John chapter 21, verses 15 to 19. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said, "you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep. I tell you the truth. When you were younger, you dressed yourself and you went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. And then he said to him, "Follow me."
The title of my message this morning is Forgiven, Restored and Released. For those of you who joined us last week, you will remember that we left the disciples having to trust and obey. Jesus had risen from the dead, and scripture says that he had appeared to the disciples twice in that upper room. And on each occasion, the disciples had all been together. I wonder what the disciples were thinking. They had seen Jesus with their own eyes, and Thomas had actually put his hand in the side of Jesus where the spear went in. The disciples had witnessed this, so they knew that Jesus had indeed risen from the dead, just like he said he would. So they trusted what he said to be true, and they were obeying him by being together and waiting. And then in the scripture that was read out this morning, we find that Jesus appears to the disciples a third time. And this time, it's not in that upper room, but it's on the beach. The reading that was read this morning focuses on Peter. The others were there, but something significant happened to Peter. I want you to imagine how Peter was feeling. He had seen Jesus twice before since the resurrection, but each time all the other disciples were gathered there. But the time previous to that was the night that Jesus was arrested. Cast your mind back to that awful, awful night when firstly Jesus had asked his closest friends to stay awake with him whilst he prayed. And yet they all fell asleep, including Peter. So Jesus used final moments with his friends or spent alone because they all fell asleep. And then, as we know, worse was to follow. Jesus was arrested and taken away by the soldiers, and Peter followed at a distance just to see what would happen to Jesus. Hiding in the shadows, not wanting to be associated with his friend and master. And yet he was seen three times, and three times he was asked, "Do you know this man? You was his friend." And three times Peter denied it and said, "No, you must be mistaken. It wasn't me. I don't know him." And then, as we know, the cock crowed. It says in the Gospel of Luke that the Lord turned round and looked straight at Peter. And Peter remembered what Jesus had said, that he would betray him that night. And Peter went out and wept bitterly. That was the last time Peter had seen Jesus alive. He didn't go to the crucifixion. He kept well hidden for fear of being arrested. And now here he was with Jesus, sitting on the beach, cooking breakfast for the disciples. What do you think was going through the mind of Peter? Put yourself in his position. Shame, guilt. Did he think that now, perhaps in front of all the disciples, Jesus would tell them all what he had done? Peter had bragged so many times what a devout follower he was. Do you remember him saying, "I won't let you wash my feet, you must wash all of me." And then also there was that time that he declared, "They'll all desert you, I never will." Peter had been one of Jesus' closest friends, and look at what he had done. He had fallen asleep when Jesus needed him to be close by him. He had denied knowing him when Jesus needed him the most. And then, not even having the decency or respect to be by Jesus when he was crucified. The women were all there, John was there, but Peter was nowhere to be seen. And now, here was Jesus in front of him. What would Jesus do? What would Jesus say? Peter bitterly regretted his behavior. Yes, he was ashamed. Yes, he wished he could turn the clock back and then things would have been different. But no amount of sorries would be enough for Jesus to forgive him for what he had done. Haven't we all at some time or another in our life done something similar to Peter? Perhaps let down our best friend, not stuck up for them when we have heard others talking about them behind their back, not being there for them when they needed us. Perhaps you were saying, "No, not me, I've never done that." Really? Look back over your own life. Hasn't there been a time when you have let someone down? done something that you knew would hurt that other person? Harsh words spoken in anger? Was it to your partner, your wife, your husband, or your best friend? How many marriages have been destroyed or broken by one or the other being betrayed? How many friendships have been ruined or spoiled because you weren't there for them when they needed you? How many times since then have you said, "I'm sorry, please forgive me," only to have your apology rejected and thrown back at you? Well, maybe the person you have hurt say that they've forgiven you, but then at every opportunity, they throw your misdemeanor in your face. Or there is always that look of mistrust in their eyes or actions. Yes, I'm sure many of us here today can identify with how Peter was feeling that morning, seeing Jesus again. What was Jesus going to do? What would he say? He had no hope that Jesus would forgive him after all that he had done. He sees the person he loves, his saviour and friend, sitting on the beach. And I should imagine his stomach tightens and his heart aches at all the pain that he has caused this man. I should imagine he longs to rush at his feet and beg his forgiveness, but he's too ashamed to. He doesn't deserve Jesus' forgiveness. And so he waits and he looks at Jesus. And Jesus says four words to him. "Do you love me?" What a strange question. And in true Peter style, he says, "You know that I love you." And Jesus replies, "Take care of my lambs." And again says to him, "Do you love me?" And Peter answers, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And again, Jesus replies, "Take care of my sheep." And then he says a third time, "Do you love me?" And scripture says that Peter was sad and he said, "Lord, you know everything about me. You know that I love you." And Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." You may be thinking, what a strange conversation. But if you remember, when Jesus was alive, he often talked in riddles or parables or told stories that had hidden meanings. And in the same way, this is not a normal conversation. Jesus knew Peter. Jesus didn't need to forgive Peter because he knew him and he loved him. And he knew that, yes, Peter had messed up, but he knew Peter's heart. He knew that Peter was ashamed of what he had done. And despite what he had done, he did truly love Jesus. How often have each of us done things that we don't know why we did them, but we did. You see, Jesus knew that despite what had happened, Peter did truly love him. You see, what was happening here was that Jesus couldn't use Peter unless Peter could forgive himself. Well, that's something to think about, isn't it? Peter needed to forgive himself, and he also needed to accept Jesus' forgiveness. You see, unless we can believe that we are forgiven, then we can't move on. We will always have regrets of, "Oh, I wish I hadn't done that." We need to accept forgiveness before we can move on. And that is what Jesus is doing here. He is making sure that Peter accepts the forgiveness that he is offering. If we remember Judas couldn't forgive himself for betraying Jesus, and he couldn't accept Jesus' forgiveness of him. He was so ashamed that he couldn't live with himself, and he hung himself. You see, holding on to guilt and not accepting forgiveness is very powerful. When Peter had answered, "Yes, I love you," what he was really saying was, "Yes, I do love you." And by saying he loves Jesus, he was accepting that forgiveness. "I love you." Three very powerful words that say so much. You see, when we say we love Jesus, we are also saying, "I'm sorry for the things I've done wrong. And I know that because that you love me, that you have forgiven me. And because of that, I can be free." When you say, "I love you," that is what you are also saying. Well, what happens next? From out of the pit of despair, shame, and guilt, Jesus then tells Peter he's going to use him to build his church. Yes, him, Peter. He tells him, feed my sheep. The reason why Jesus could use Peter was because that Peter knew that he was a sinner. Yes, he had been forgiven, but he was in no illusions of being good or saintly. Therefore, he could lead people from a place of humility. That is also what Jesus was looking for. And he does the same with each of us. See, Peter was not only forgiven, he was restored and then released to work for Jesus, to tell people about him. Jesus knew he could trust Peter, and he knew that because of the love that Peter had for him, he also would be crucified for his faith. Jesus was now giving Peter the greatest commission, go and build my church. And it's because of Peter that the Christian church was founded. Each of us can learn so much from the scriptures today. Firstly, have you ever done something that you think is so bad that you can't be forgiven for? Well, that's not true. If, like Peter, you are truly sorry, then come to Jesus and let him lift that heavy burden and receive his forgiveness today. He will never throw that sin back in your face, because you see, when Jesus forgives, he also forgets. We are given a blank page. There is no need to carry on blaming yourself for something that you have done and that you now regret. Whoever it was that you hurt, then yes, ask their forgiveness. But if they don't give it, then that is their problem and they will have to live with that. Because Jesus says, unless we forgive others of their sins, how can he forgive us? So ask for forgiveness from them. And then ask Jesus for forgiveness and then walk free. If you are the person that has been holding the pain of the actions of another, then now is the time for you to forgive them. Some things are really hard to forgive, and that is why you need Jesus to help you. But you also can't move forward unless you forgive that person and forget what has been done to you. Jesus is asking the same question of each of us. Do you love me? It's not that he doubts us, but he wants us to recognize how we express that love. Ask ourselves the question, what have I done for Christ? What am I doing for Christ? What will I do? And Peter with confidence said, yes, Lord, I do love you. Can we say with confidence, yes, Lord, I love you? Our actions may sometimes not reflect that love, and Jesus understands that too. But are we able to say, yes, Lord, I do love you? And then he is saying to each one of us, feed my sheep, to share our lives with others, to tell people about him and what he has done for us and what he can do for them. Can you respond with, yes, Lord, I love you? Do you know Jesus as your own Lord and Saviour? We're going to sing a prayer song now to remind each of us that we too are forgiven and have been given a new beginning. It's up to us then how we respond with this wonderful love that God has shown to each of us for forgiving us our sins. How do we demonstrate our love for him? If today you need to know you're forgiven or you need help in forgiving someone else, then come to Jesus as we sing this song and let God heal and forgive you through the words and through his Holy Spirit speaking to you today.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Dear Father God, we thank you by your mercy and grace and the blood that was shed for us at Calvary that we can know that our sins are forgiven. And I pray if there's anybody with us today that needs to know that assurance for themselves, then please come and bring healing to those damaged hearts. I ask this in your precious name. Amen. We're now going to sing our last song together. It's a song of victory. Because you see, if we know Jesus, we can stand and overcome what the world throws at us. Because Jesus has overcome the enemy. And so as we sing this song together, stir your spirit and know that God is in this battle with you. And you will overcome if you know him. And then this will be followed by the benediction. Benediction. May the God of grace breathe health into your body, love into your heart, peace into your mind, and joy into your spirit. Amen. May God bless you and keep you safe until we meet again.
Stand in wonder once again. Your grace grace still amazes me. Your grace still amazes me. Still love.